there was a very strange parallel development in Leicestershire. It has emerged that on Tuesday the 8th of May, 5 days after Madeleine's reported disappearance, a high-powered committee consisting of top people from many government departments and secret service agencies was set up under the chairmanship of the then Chief Constable of Leicestershire Police, Matt Baggett. He later told the Leveson Inquiry, on the 8th of May 2007, Leicestershire Constabulary was asked to coordinate the UK response to assist the Portuguese inquiry on behalf of the UK Government and Association of Chief Police Officers. A coordination group was set up on behalf of law enforcement agencies and government departments to coordinate the media interaction and ensure that a consistent stance was taken. Not to look for Madeleine then, but to coordinate the media interaction. All those law enforcement agencies and government departments tightly coordinated to control what comes out in the media. Something very big must have been at stake. Within a week, there were so many British police officers crowding in on the Portuguese police that Amaral was forced to place at their disposal a room next to our crisis unit. Describing this army of British staff, Amaral said, "Specialists from various police services, including Scotland Yard, special surveillance teams, as well as information and telecommunications technicians, all turning up with their laptops and various high-tech equipment. Many others, notably criminal profilers, British analysts traced timelines and patterns of connections based on the witness statements gathered. They produce giant summary boards that cover the walls of the offices. They attend all our meetings and collaborate in decision-making." We now know that MI5 was interested in the case and sent representatives to Portugal. Special Branch became involved. Jim Gamble, then the head of the Child Exploitation and Online Protection Centre, sent some of his staff. Gamble very soon called for anyone who had holidayed in Praia da Luz to send him their holiday photos. And ever since, Gamble, though no longer head of CEOP, has stood shoulder to shoulder with the McCanns at every twist and turn, and even now campaigns for them on Twitter. Amaral in his book tells us, "It was the work of these British criminal profilers who helped to put into the minds of the Portuguese police investigators that Robert Murat might be the likely abductor. Members of the British agency CEOP take a close interest in Murat and work to develop his psychological profile." Amaral had been forced to turn his attention to Murat by the huge attention being paid to him by the world's media and by the disturbing report he had received from Inspector Veranda. Amaral explains, "They have heard about the statement from one of his childhood friends, put on the file by the police department. According to him, Murat had an affirmed penchant for bestiality. Moreover, he allegedly attempted to rape his 16-year-old cousin. This individual describes Murat as someone who was violent, with behavioural problems, a sexual pervert, sadist and misanthropist. We are somewhat sceptical. All the same, according to the English profilers, there is a 90% chance that he is the guilty party." The event that clinched Amaral's decision to make Murat a formal suspect was the decision of the McCann's close friend, Jane Tanner, to identify Murat as the man she said she had seen carrying a child at around 9:15 p.m. on the night Madeleine was reported missing. "I dealt with this in my second Madeleine film, The Phantoms." Amaral goes on, "Murat's behaviour starts to seriously intrigue me. He often makes references to similar cases that happened in the United Kingdom and which he seems to know in detail. He displays suspicious curiosity and seeks to know more. He offers to help us identify suspects. He knows the workings of the Ocean Club and the habits of the holidaymakers very well. He even tried to secretly access the investigation files. It is also known that he visits websites of a pornographic nature. His mother has set up a desk near the tapas restaurant in order to gather and give out information about Madeleine. We don't know if this woman's actions are philanthropic in nature or if she is hoping to keep well informed of all the information circling about the case. Members of the British agency CEOP take a close interest in Murat and work to develop his psychological profile. Before the search, we want to assure ourselves that Jane Tanner recognises him as the individual she saw on the night of the disappearance. She is sitting inside an unmarked car, whose tinted windows allow her to see out without being spotted. The vehicle is parked at the exact spot where she says on the night of the 3rd of May, Robert Murat, anonymous amongst plainclothes police officers, goes up the road in the same way, says Tanner, as the alleged abductor. Jane Tanner is adamant. It certainly is Robert Murat that she saw that night. She definitely recognises his way of walking. Then in his book, Amaral writes, but does he resemble the description she painted previously? No, he doesn't. To understand why Jane Tanner made this identification of Murat, I will reveal what we now know happened just before Jane Tanner made this remarkable identification. It turns out that immediately prior to identifying Murat, she spent time with a very senior Leicestershire police officer, Detective Chief Superintendent Bob Small. But she also admits that she talked to two men from the government-backed firm Control Risks Group, Kenneth Farrow and Michael Keenan. This is how Wikipedia describes the firm. Control Risks is a global risk and strategic consulting firm specialising in political, security and integrity risk. Operating from 36 offices, the company's primary service include anti-corruption audits, consultancy and training, e-discovery, political risk analysis and a broad range of security and crisis management support. In September 2007, David Brown for The Times wrote, Kate and Jerry McCann turned to the company which employs former members of the intelligence services and special forces after becoming concerned that officers in the Algarve assumed their daughter was dead. A source close to the couple's legal team confirmed that Control Risks Group had been working with the family since May, but refused to discuss how the company was being paid. The idea that Control Risks Group was searching for Madeleine is ridiculous. They had zero experience in looking for missing children. All the indications are that the government was funding them and that they were an integral part of the government's attempt to cover up what really happened to Madeleine. And as Jane Tanner herself confessed, Control Risks were at the very heart of the attempt to frame Murat as the abductor. It seems highly probable that Control Risks and Bob Small were instrumental in manipulating Jane Tanner to positively identify Robert Murat as the man she said she saw carrying a child. This identification was the catalyst which made Robert Murat into an official suspect. And so it was that the police searched Murat's home on the 14th of May and took him in for questioning. It was headline news across the world. I suggest by now it is becoming clear that there was a coordinated plot to frame Robert Murat, have him arrested and made a suspect. If that is in doubt, what followed surely confirmed it. During the 2 days that followed Murat being made a suspect, no fewer than three members of the Tapas 7 suddenly remembered that they had seen Robert Murat hanging around near the McCann's apartment talking to some of the group soon after Madeleine was reported missing. According to Rachel Oldfield, one of the Tapas 7, she said she saw Murat on a Sky News report and immediately claimed to Jane Tanner that she had seen Murat on the night of the 3rd of May near the Ocean Club. Fiona Payne, another Tapas 7 friend of the McCann's, then said the same. And then Dr. Russell O'Brien said he also had actually met Murat on the night of the 3rd of May. He later changed that, however, and claimed he'd met Murat the following morning, and actually put Murat's phone number into his mobile list of contacts. 2 days after Murat was made a suspect, Rachel Oldfield, Fiona Payne and Dr. Russell O'Brien all made statements to the police which put Murat close to the scene of the alleged abduction on the night in question. This would have confirmed to Amaral and his team that they were on the right track. But Gonçalo Amaral was suspicious about their statements, so decided to arrange for the three Tapas 7 members to meet with Robert Murat in a tiny room, kneecap to kneecap, in the Portimao police station on the 11th of July. He wrote, "A confrontation is organised between the witnesses. Nothing new comes out of it. The former persist in stating that the suspect was definitely in the area on the night of the disappearance. Murat denies the whole thing and even accuses them of lying. Each side stands its ground." In the coming months, five other people also remembered having seen Murat near the McCann's apartment that night. That is according to newspaper reports probably sourced from the McCann's PR spokesman Clarence Mitchell. The Daily Mail named the five as including holidaymaker Jane Jensen, an unnamed British barrister, and two people that had contacted the McCann's investigation hotline. But then, in 2008, Not long after Amaral was removed from the investigation, several of the 8 people who said they remembered seeing Murat suddenly admitted they might have been confused with another person. Either David Payne or Angus Symington, one of the owners of the Ocean Club, who was said to resemble Murat. The Daily Mail said, doubt was cast on the evidence of several key witnesses in the Madeleine McCann disappearance last night. Those who said they saw suspect Robert Murat outside the family's holiday apartment on the night she vanished may have named the wrong man, it was revealed. Detectives believe the witnesses who said they saw the British expat could have confused him with a friend of Kate and Jerry McCann, David Payne, who was out searching for the missing 3-year-old. A series of witnesses had given statements claiming to have seen him around the Ocean Club apartment complex in the hours after Mrs. McCann, 39, raised the alarm. They included 3 friends of the McCanns, Russell O'Brien, Fiona Payne and Rachel Oldfield. It looks to me as though it was convenient and helpful to the McCanns to have the attention focused on Murat as a suspect. But several months later, it seems to have been convenient to drop Murat as a suspect. This may have occurred because of a crucial meeting held on the 13th of November 2007, which I'll come to in a moment. I should just add that in April 2008, the Tapas 3, Rachel Oldfield, Fiona Payne and Russell O'Brien, were re-questioned at Enderby, Leicestershire Police Headquarters by Leicestershire Police on the instructions of the Portuguese police. All were re-questioned in some depth about their claims of speaking with Robert Murat on the evening of the 3rd of May. Rachel Oldfield and Fiona Payne stuck to their story, but Russell O'Brien admitted that he had only seen Murat on the morning after and not the night before. There's one more episode that we need to look at, which I mentioned briefly in my first Madeleine film, and that's the moment Jerry McCann was asked by an interviewer, did you already know Robert Murat?
Jerry McCann, negou conhecê-lo.
But did you know Robert Murat?
I'm not going to comment on that.
Os avanços no processo podem ditar novos interrogatórios ao casal McCann, que deve voltar a Portimão no final desta semana.
In my opinion, it is a real possibility that Jerry McCann had previously met Murat, and that would be hugely significant. Many news organisations from many countries covered the Madeleine McCann case. Sky News gave the case intensive coverage. Their man in Pride of Luz was their chief crime correspondent, Martin Brunt. I'm going to take a brief look now at the 2 phone calls Brunt made to Robert Murat. The first, secretly recorded by the Portuguese police and published by them in August 2008, took place on the 15th of May, the day after Murat had been made a suspect. His mother, Jennifer Murat, picked up the call. It went like this.
Hello, residents of Jenny Murat.
Hello, Martin Brunt speaking.
Hi, dear.
Hi, is everything all right?
Yes, Robert is a little depressed now.
I'm sure he is.
It wasn't very nice of Sky News to refer to him as our Guido, don't you think?
I didn't see that. I was up at our house.
What are they saying in regard to that? Robert Murat has been made an arguido in the case of Madeleine McCann.
What does the term arguido mean in Portuguese?
What does the term arguido mean, Robert?
Suspect.
Suspect.
Okay, well, I'm not completely familiar with the legal Portuguese terms. I think that someone said that the police said they were treating Robert as an arguido.
Robert, as an arguido?
What I mean is, what is that?
I'm going to pass you to Robert. Don't hang up, Martin.
Okay, thanks. Hello, Martin.
Hello, Robert.
Your number didn't show up. That's why I didn't know who it was.
Oh, I didn't send you my number.
That's okay. Well, I will see if I manage not to lose this one, if I can find the tool.
Okay, we will try. I mean, I have not seen it yet, but we will try to explain. The police say, or was it the local journalists who say, you should be treated as an arguido,
that he is a suspect, basically.
Yes, well, even so, given the tone of the interrogation and the fact of being free, which says a lot about the interest in you, eh?
That is the same as finishing me off. It was not me. I didn't do anything. And now I am literally...
Okay, I know, I think.
It's always on when I turn the TV on, and even now.
Yes, well, it would be better to turn it off.
Really, to have been quiet was the best thing I could have done.
Yes,
but when I turn the television on, I think, they are going to finish me completely. They are finishing me off.
Okay, I'm going to tell you that
in order to have an idea.
I'll tell you what we're going to do.
Did you talk to the lawyer?
Two things. We talked to the Sky lawyer.
Right.
Who was of the opinion that according to what you signed, you reported your work as being that of a translator.
Certainly. As far as... The thing is that it was... Let me... It probably is.
Oh. Go on, continue.
We talked to a Sky lawyer. But the problem with the Sky lawyer is that he is English.
Yes. No. He is our lawyer.
Hmm.
And you can see, he said what it seemed to be to him.
Hmm.
According to his understanding.
According to his understanding, exactly.
And now we are reluctant to talk to the lawyer who contacted you.
That's right, okay.
We do not know him.
Okay.
And you do not know him. Well, you don't.
Exactly, that's right. I do not know him, mate.
And we do not know where he came from or what his credibility is.
Yes.
And they told us that the police were going to play games with false leads. And that was why... And who knows whether he is who he says he is.
That's right, okay.
And he could be trying to test you out, or hoping that we pass him some information.
Certainly.
We know that you suspect your calls are being listened to because of this. Right. Because of this reason, we are very reluctant, because we do not know him, and you do not know him.
But however, I mean, the best option you have to come clean with this would probably be to go with a lawyer from Lisbon. Somebody with someone from up there. Not from the Algarve. It would have to be someone from Lisbon. Is that okay?
That's okay. I will try and arrange for someone from there. But...
Okay.
But our position in relation to all this, for the moment, as I has explained previously, is that we consider ourselves to be very important, and I think it was your opinion initially to do something finally that would manage to be on your side.
Yes, and that would not lead to my being detained immediately.
Of course. And you know, many of the things that you told me were not attributed to me. I understand, and I don't want to enter into all those details. And we did not do anything since I left you.
No.
I'm sure you understand.
Yes.
And if there is anything that better clarifies that you think you could say, that could also be used in the future.
Of course.
You know, you could quote Sky sources and others.
Yes, that would be perfect. That would be just perfect.
But I think it is important that you should have the media there, and if we could appear briefly and make statements in these terms. I was questioned, it was a vague questioning, I was not asked direct questions about Madeleine, and afterwards you explained to me how you felt that they made you a scapegoat, that you have nothing to hide, even if your computer is analysed, and at the end of the day you will be absolved, and they will find the true abductor or kidnapper.
You could. Let's first look at this with a Portuguese lawyer. We will, won't we?
Yes. No.
Are you going to do this?
I will do my best to arrange for one now.
Yes.
But independently of what the lawyer thinks, I think that this is the clearest option. But we will have to try to find someone who...
Yes, I think this is the simplest. Can you confirm this? I am here having a family discussion to see what they think.
Ah, yes, of course I will. But I'm talking about making very clear statements.
Yes, okay.
That they do not enter into many details, but into the way you can get your message across.
Get it across, okay.
That you give your version of events, given that the only version of events is vague, and...
Yes.
And that the two local journalists and everyone are against you, and that there is nobody, with the exception of my interview with Sally...
Yes.
There has nobody who has spoken in favour of Robert Murat because of this.
In fact, of the many interviews given, I have heard that there were some positive ones, people contradicting each other.
Yes.
They arrived and said, no, they have been very positive about this.
Of course. People from the area.
People from here, exactly.
Who know what happened?
Many people from the area said very positive things about this, about me, which is useful.
Of course. Well, I will see what I can find and get back in touch with you.
Okay, bye.
And if we agree on this?
Yes.
And if we could agree to appear for 15 minutes?
I never have any problem with making a statement.
Okay.
I have no problem with that, whilst I have the legal cover to do so, because I don't want to end up in prison.
That would be the last thing we want.
Firstly, for something I did not do. And secondly, for something that would break their contract rules.
I understand that, and I understand the sensitive nature of everything that we have been working with since we arrived here. So,
okay.
Can I phone you again in half an hour? Goodbye. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
So in this phone call, we have evidence that the Murats and Martin Brunt are on familiar terms. Murat calls Brunt mate. Also, we note that Brunt has a house in Praia da Luz, something he has confirmed elsewhere. Evidently, Brunt and Murat had already been talking before his arrest, for example, about the help Brunt was offering from Sky News' legal department. But most significant is where Murat says, "I don't want to go to prison," and gives two reasons. One, he never did it, but also for something that would break their contract rules. Immediately, Brunt realises that Murat has touched on a very sensitive subject and replies, using very guarded language, "I understand the sensitive nature of everything that we have been working with since we arrived here." Murat refers to a contract. What sort of contract is that? Who is the contract with? What are its terms? Murat apparently thinks he might be breaking some contract rules by being interviewed by Martin Brunt. Brunt refers to the sensitive nature of the issue about the contract. He then refers to everything that we've been working with since we arrived here. So what exactly is everything we have been working with? And for how long have they been working with this thing? Well, Brunt says, since we arrived here. When did Sky News and Brunt arrive in Praia da Luz? Well, Sky News was there the very first day Madeleine was reported missing, the 4th of May. What were they discussing? I've covered Murat in detail because I suggest he is a key part of the whole story, although it's clear he was in England when I suggest Madeleine actually died. I suggest from all of the evidence we've looked at so far, Murat was called over to Portugal on behalf of government security services to help plan the abduction hoax that took place at around 10 p.m. on the 3rd of May. I suggest he was already known to security services. I suggest in some capacity he already knew Jerry McCann. In my opinion, his roles probably included, firstly, finding a property with a freezer where Madeleine's body could be conveniently stored and assisting in taking it there. Secondly, volunteering to act as an interpreter. And thirdly, whilst an interpreter, finding out all he could and also suggesting bogus lines of inquiry. It's clear to me he was then framed, but was he willingly framed? On balance, I think this is very possible. One of the reasons I suggest this is that he agreed to be interviewed by the Portuguese police without exercising his right to have a solicitor present to advise him. Yet he comprehensively lied during this first interview. I think he must have known or had good reason to believe that he would be protected. I suggest he was a known security services asset, probably to MI5, and deliberately participated in a complex plot to create an abduction scenario. It follows from that, if the security services were involved in this cover-up, as I demonstrated they were in my first Madeleine film, then in some way, which I will come to in a moment, the reason for their involvement must have been to hide some particularly illegal and or immoral activity that would threaten the UK government if its existence became known. Before leaving the subject of Robert Murat, I want to look at a highly unusual meeting that took place on the 13th of November 2007 at the Villa Salsalitas, owned by Robert Murat's aunt and uncle, Ralph and Sally Everley. Present at this meeting were five people from what I call the Murat camp, and two from the McCann camp. Let's remember at this time, the McCanns had been made formal suspects over 2 months previously. There were now three suspects, Robert Murat, Jerry McCann and Kate McCann. Let's also recall that exactly 6 weeks before this meeting, Gonçalo Amaral had been removed from the investigation due to diplomatic pressure from the UK government and apparently replaced by a puppet, Paulo Rebelo, whose job appeared to be to quietly close down the investigation. So who was at this meeting? In the Murat camp, Robert Murat, Ralph Evelay, Murat's uncle, Sally Evelay, Murat's aunt, Jennifer Murat, Murat's mother, and Francisco Pagaret, Murat's lawyer. In the McCann camp, Brian Kennedy, the Cheshire businessman worth around £250 million, one of Britain's richest people, who directed the Find Madeleine investigation and appointed all the dodgy investigation agencies that I covered in my first Madeleine film. And Edward Smethurst, senior Freemason and past Grand Master of the East Lancashire Masonic Province, the man who has acted as the McCann's coordinating solicitor throughout, and who has been a director of the Find Madeleine Fund since 2009. Smethurst is also alleged to have holidayed every year in Praia da Luz since 1999. Is that just a coincidence? On both sides then, big guns were employed. The meeting was intended to be secret. But when news of it was leaked to the Portuguese press 2 weeks later, Brian Kennedy said the purpose of the meeting was for him to offer Murat a job looking for Madeleine. I believe that was a lie. So what was this meeting really about? Four members of the Tapas Seven had effectively accused Murat of being involved. Jane Tanner had even said he was the actual abductor. The first thing that stands out is the McCann team must have known that Murat was not the abductor. Otherwise, why send Kennedy and Smethurst to meet him? I suggest this was a planning meeting between the two camps. Something had gone wrong when Madeleine unexpectedly died around the second day of the McCann's holiday. Murat, I suggest, had been actively involved in the subsequent cover-up. I keep in mind the possibility that Murat was not a willing patsy. But whether he was or not, I suggest that the purpose of this meeting was to strike some sort of deal. That is perhaps why top lawyers were involved on both sides. The events that followed soon after this meeting are very interesting. Just 4 days later, the Tapas Seven and an array of lawyers and PR agents, including of course Clarence Mitchell, met for a day-long get-together at the Rothley Court Hotel, just down the road from the McCann's house. When news of that meeting leaked out, Clarence Mitchell said it was just a friendly reunion. Anything that comes out of Mitchell's mouth, in my opinion, must immediately be assumed to be a lie unless evidence can be found which shows it to be true. Then weeks later, several people changed their stories about Murat, saying they'd probably mixed him up with someone else. Just weeks after that, Murat started libel proceedings in the High Court and was very shortly handed over £600,000 in an out-of-court settlement, which was rapidly agreed to by several print and TV media. A few weeks after Murat netted £600,000, the McCanns achieved another £550,000 in another out-of-court settlement. Interviewed days after this huge payout, Murat appeared to display no trace of anger at people like Jane Tanner and the other friends of the McCanns who had previously accused him of being the abductor. This strange interview was analysed by the criminologist who runs the popular Eyes for Lies website. She gives clear reasons why she believes Murat is lying in this interview. He seems not the least bothered about having been falsely accused of abducting Madeleine McCann. This, in my opinion, shows he was probably a willing patsy.